Modern astrophysics is built on the foundations of Big Bang cosmology. This cosmology relies on a story, first proposed by a Belgian priest, Georges Lemaître. He described his universe as being like the cosmic egg exploding at the moment of creation. Most scientists, while initially rejecting his hypothesis, soon came to endorse it. This then developed into a theory with apparent evidence to support it. The Big Bang started from something very small. The story goes that there was an entity known as a singularity that had properties at or very close to infinite density and temperature. At the same time, the whole entire universe was contained within this entity of zero spatial dimension size. This then rapidly expanded and exploded. And created all matter at every scale, from particles to galaxies. The foundation of modern science is thus built on the religious notion of Big Bang creationism. The cosmic background radiation is used as part of the alleged evidence for the Big Bang. This radiation is basically the typical background temperature of space. Up until the first confirmed measurement of the CMB radiation, temperature predictions produced by Big Bang proponents fluctuated up and down between 5 and 50 Kelvin over several years. Some estimates were as high as 40 Kelvin, just 3 years before Penzias and Wilson confidently measured a temperature of 3.5 Kelvin. But some scientists predicted a cosmic background temperature independent of Big Bang assumptions. In 1896, Charles-Édouard Guillaume thought that an interstellar temperature of 5.6 Kelvin could be produced from starlight. Andrew McKellar, an astronomer, predicted a temperature of 2.3 Kelvin in 1941. He posited that radiative excitation of cyanoradicals, a type of interstellar molecule, could be the cause of this background temperature. He did not reference the Big Bang. Another apparent phenomenon that Big Bang cosmologists use to argue their theory is the existence of redshift. The Doppler redshift effect is the result of the stretching of the wavelength of light towards the red part of the color spectrum. This shift towards the red happens if the source of the light is moving away from the observer. The cosmological redshift is the shifting of the wavelength of light towards the red as it traverses the expanding universe. Halton Arp, a former colleague of Edwin Hubble, has collected hundreds of examples of high redshift quasars that are closely associated with low redshift galaxies. If the quasar, Object 1, is physically connected to the parent galaxy, then this falsifies the notion that the quasar is twice as far away as the parent galaxy, a notion which the redshift value would erroneously dictate. Amazingly, the two quasars, Object 2 and Object 3, are supposed to be more than 10 times further away than the main galaxy, NGC 7603, according to the redshift values. But clearly, they are part of the connected bridge. Halton Arp discovered an apparent physical connection between several galaxies and nearby quasars with higher redshift values than the parent galaxy. He formulated a theory that the quasars were new objects that were ejected out of the parent galaxy. These new objects are highly redshifted due to the change in the mass of electrons in a plasma over a period of time. Arp proposes that high redshift objects have a lower electron mass than low redshifted objects. Thus, the redshift can be intrinsic. Redshifts can be used to extrapolate distance, but in outer space, this correlation can break down rapidly and become useless, especially if laboratory evidence shows that electron density in plasma can also account for this effect. The Big Bang theory seems to defy the alleged force of gravity that mainstream cosmologists regard as the dominating power of the visible universe. What force could have overcome the seemingly infinite pull of gravity in the singularity that began our universe? Some scientists assume that the universe is closed. They claim that eventually gravity will catch up with the expansion and pull all matter back into a singularity. Meanwhile, many scientists claim that mysterious invisible matter with its own mass has to account for apparent observations of expansion as well as various perceived masses of galaxies. A quote from the NASA website states that roughly 70% of the universe is dark energy. Dark matter makes up about 25%, the rest. Everything on Earth, everything ever observed with all of our instruments, all normal matter, adds up to less than 5% of the universe. Dark matter, conventional matter, and dark energy, these are seen as the main forces which shape the behavior and morphology of our universe. Do we really need dark matter or dark energy to explain what conventional matter and gravity cannot? Or could electric currents in a plasma universe account for the apparent speed and morphology of such apparent anomalies? And what exactly is a plasma? Plasma is a highly electrically conductive state of matter. Plasma consists of freely moving particles with electrical charge. In cosmic plasma, particles are typically free electrons, protons, and atoms stripped of their electrons, positive ions. It does not behave like neutral gases. Electric currents and magnetic fields are the dominant force within such a medium. And electromagnetism is vastly more powerful than gravity. Due to the way it interacts with electromagnetism, plasma exhibits a distinctly complex structure and morphology that sets it apart from the behavior and morphology of neutral gases, liquids, and solids. Plasma tends to manifest itself in cellular and filamentary structures. As plasma physicist Wal Thornhill says, plasma can self-organize into cells of differing electrical characteristics. Electric currents in plasma form filaments that attract each other at long distances and repel each other at short distances. These filaments tend to braid themselves into ropes that act as power transmission lines, with virtually no limit to the distances over which they can operate. In the rarefied plasma of space, the subtle flow of electricity is not easily measured. But these currents leave a definitive signature, a network of magnetic fields throughout the observed universe. Astronomers detect these fields, but give no attention to the electric cause. Magnetic fields are produced only by electricity. How does the mainstream see these magnetic fields in space? Clearly, in a different way. In his paper at the American Institute of Physics, First Crisis in Cosmology Conference in 2005, electrical engineering professor Dr. Donald E. Scott stated that fundamental disagreements about the properties and behavior of electromagnetic fields in space plasmas exist between the science of modern astronomy and the experimentally verified laws of electrical engineering and physics. Mainstream theorists claim that magnetic fields begin and end on molecular clouds of space plasma. They are apparently frozen in. Whereas electrical engineers state that laboratory evidence proves that magnetic fields have no beginning and end. Hannes Alfvén, the father of plasma cosmology, took great pains to emphasize the importance of electricity in space plasma. His papers on phenomena such as double layers, Birkeland currents, and Z-pinches were pioneering, but sadly ignored by most astrophysicists. Decades ago, Hannes Alfvén explained that the highly misleading concept of frozen-in magnetic fields does not actually exist in nature. Alfvén found that magnetic fields in space must be the product of circuits of current flowing through space. The proponents of gravitational theory had no idea about the dominance of plasma in the observable universe. Thanks to the advent of advanced radio telescopes and other improved instrumentation, we have come to discover this important fact as the 20th century progressed. Unfortunately, mainstream cosmology, built on a large foundation of speculative assumptions, continues to obfuscate and relegate the significance of these discoveries. If electric currents are coursing through the darkness of space and discharging to produce the visible light of the universe, then gravity cannot be responsible for what we see. One of their concepts is known as magnetic reconnection. Wikipedia describes it as a physical process in highly conducting plasmas in which the magnetic topology is rearranged and magnetic energy is converted to kinetic energy, thermal energy, and particle acceleration. Yet, Hannes Alfvén, despite originally formulating it, later stated that the concept of magnetic merging or reconnection was a pseudoscience, which was infecting cosmology and even plasma science at the time. Yet, most astronomers chose not to listen, and thus the role of electricity in space is relegated in comparison to the reign of strange and exotic assumptions. The mathematicians, as some call them, have taken over. We will soon see how important electricity in space actually is and what role gravity really has to play. Electric currents are a prominent feature not only in space, but also our upper atmosphere. The aurora are currents of charged particles twisting and spiraling through the ionosphere. The electric currents of the aurora are named after the Norwegian scientist Christian Birkeland. In 1908, Birkeland wrote, "The currents there in the aurora are imagined as having come into existence mainly as a secondary effect of the electric corpuscles from the sun drawn in out of space." He proposed that polar electric currents entered the ionosphere and flowed along the geomagnetic field lines. His theory of field-aligned currents originating from the sun was dismissed by most scientists. Birkeland currents are amazingly efficient mechanisms of transmitting electricity through space. The behavior of these current filaments are often highly dynamic. The observable universe is full of these Birkeland currents. In the filament, the electric current becomes insulated from the surrounding space plasma due to the existence of a spinning vortex of charged particles around the central axial current. The rotating vortex consists of layers of positive and negative charge that are adjacent to each other. They form sheaths that prevent the central current from discharging into the bulk plasma surrounding it. Double layers are the areas of plasma defining regions of opposite charge as well as with different characteristics. The voltages and particle velocities in such regions can sometimes be very high indeed. In a Birkeland current, each particle follows the magnetic field which is present at its particular location. The movement of charged particles in these magnetic fields also results in the particle creating its own magnetic field. The further away a particle is from the central axis, the more circular its path. Birkeland currents almost always occur in pairs, currents that often spiral and twist around each other. Their interaction is governed by Ampère's force law. Two axial currents that are moving in the same direction will attract each other if they are parallel. This attractive force is inversely proportional to their distance apart. Birkeland currents create a long-range attractive force from the axial currents, but a short-range repulsive one from the radial spiraling currents between filaments. The complex interactions between these currents result in a highly complex and dynamic observable universe. Regions of differing plasma density, temperature, atomic composition interact and help create regional cells of plasma. Here, Birkeland currents interact as part of a typical unique plasma cell in space. Plasma dynamics are often so complex that they are impossible to perfectly model collectively. Our understanding of bulk interactions is still far from perfect. As Hannes Alfvén said, when, by an immense number of vectors and tensors and integral equations, theoreticians have prescribed what a plasma must do, the plasma, like a naughty child, refuses to obey. A key feature of cosmic plasma, neglected by astronomers, is known as the pinch effect. The radial magnetic field around pairs of Birkeland currents can often become strong enough to compress the currents and cause various instabilities. The Bennett pinch is named after Willard Harrison Bennett, who first investigated them in terrestrial plasmas in the 1930s. Such features can also be seen in space plasma. Thank you. When a soda can is placed in a wire that generates a large pulse of electric current, the magnetic pinch produced by the current can crush the can into an hourglass shape. The pinch effect can also compress electric currents into spherical or toroidal forms of plasma, otherwise known as plasmoids. Here, a plasmoid can be observed in the Earth's magnetotail. And here, plasmoids can be seen forming in the current sheets of solar flares. The mainstream astrophysics community claims that such plasmoids form as a result of magnetic reconnection. Retired electrical engineer Dr. Donald E. Scott spoke at the NASA Goddard Center in 2009. In that presentation, he stated that the concept of magnetic reconnection is empirically incorrect. The electric currents in the Earth's magnetosphere are sometimes called flux ropes by the mainstream. They really should be calling them Birkeland currents, due to the fact that these are field-aligned. Plasmoids are made in bead lightning. Electric currents are compressed by powerful magnetic fields along the lightning filament. There may be evidence that plasmoids are constantly forming in all lightning and then dissipating rapidly outside the plasma environment. Cosmic lightning may be the key to star formation. In April of 2011, the European Space Agency reported the discovery of newly born stars that had been found inside networks of filaments in dusty interstellar clouds. The newly born stars were often discovered in the densest parts, and each filament was found to have the same width. This discovery was apparently a very big surprise, but it is no surprise to plasma cosmologists. In his book, The Electric Sky, electrical engineer Dr. Donald Scott hypothesized that the main electric current enters or exits the sun at the poles. The strength of the currents increase as they head towards the equatorial region. Our sun is alive with electrical activity. The concept of an electric sun changes everything. It need not be powered by a nuclear furnace at its core. Ralph Jurgens was a civil engineer by profession and a true scientific pioneer by nature. He worked as an editor in journals that focused on a subject known as K catastrophism. The subject of which derives from the work of Dr. Emanuel Velikovsky. Velikovsky was famous for proposing that planetary instability, powered by electricity, caused global catastrophe within recent human history. Velikovsky's claims produced a large amount of controversy. The mainstream astronomers saw him as a heretic, yet some of his heretical ideas are too compelling to ignore. In 1972, Juergens first published in the magazine Pensée an article titled Reconciling Celestial Mechanics and Velikovskyan Catastrophism. He wrote that the known characteristics of the interplanetary medium suggest not only that the Sun and the planets are electrically charged, but that the Sun itself is the focus of a cosmic electric discharge, the probable source of all its radiant energy. This image shows the granules appearing on the Sun's photosphere. The dynamic granulation dominates the majority of the solar surface. Mainstream theory regards the cause of such granulation to originate from convection columns emanating from the solar interior. Juergens was highly critical of the notion that violent convection from an exploding nuclear core can be observed in the photosphere of the Sun. In his 1979 paper, The Photosphere, Is It the Top or the Bottom of the Phenomenon We Call the Sun?, Juergens suggested that the granules of the photosphere are part of an anode in an electric circuit. He wrote that the electric sun hypothesis assigns the solar body the role of anode, that of the higher potential electrode, in a cosmical electric discharge. He further stated that considering this and recognizing granules as cells of secondary plasma, we are led directly to ask whether the granules might not be akin to certain highly luminous tufts of discharge plasma, variously described in the literature as anode glows, anode tufts, and anode arcs. A plasma ball reveals the presence of filaments arranging together to form cells of anode tufts. The arrangement of the tufting is obviously not as dense as that which is observed on the Sun. Here, photospheric tufts can be seen forming twisting Birkeland currents that appear to descend into a sunspot. This may well be due to a steep voltage gradient. The Sun shows evidence of electric filaments arcing through its photosphere. They are known as faculae and are often simply referred to by the mainstream astronomers as concentrations of magnetic field lines. Critics of the electric model of the Sun may state that the quantitative mapping of the solar circuit is incomplete or flawed. Regardless, large amounts of galactic, high-energy electrons have been detected flowing inwards towards our solar system. If stars are produced in discharges of plasma filaments, then this nullifies the need for gravitational collapse and nuclear fusion at the core. Most Birkeland current filaments in space are in dark mode and do not glow, as the current density is too low. Yet, they occasionally increase in density and emerge out of the darkness of space as bright strings of current. Physicist Wallace Thornhill has proposed a map of the Sun's environment. The interaction between galactic filaments results in a complex series of double layers and particle combinations. Birkeland currents spiral out of the poles of the Sun, and complex magnetic fields span outwards towards the heliosheath. Our solar system has long been assumed to be governed by gravity. The planets are beautiful and majestic, and their distinct features attract much in the way of conjecture. Electrical forces may lie at the heart of the heavenly bodies and their movements. What force is ultimately responsible for the planetary features that we see? The force of gravity has a place within our Sun's heliosphere and plasma environment. But does it manifest independently of electric plasma? Could an electric force really lie behind the sun? The rotation of the sun may be the result of a very simple electrical interaction. The homopolar motor was discovered by Michael Faraday in 1821. The Faraday motor rotates parallel to the external magnetic field produced by the free electrons. The force responsible for this is known as the Lorentz force. Our sun rotates fastest in the equatorial latitude, and sunspot activity peaks in this region. The photograph shows Christian Birkeland conducting his Torella experiments with a magnetized sphere and applied electric currents. Similar features are apparent on the equator of Birkeland's sphere to that observed on our sun at solar maxima. Electric fields can also drive plasma rotation rather than just magnetic fields. The electric field of the sun has not yet been measured. While the electric force of the sun's ring current may not actually represent the sun's force of gravity or the force that causes planetary rotation, it may offer a clue as to what gravity is. The sun's behavior may be dominated more by electrodynamic plasma than the gravitational forces experienced on rocky planets. The electric charge field of the sun may extend outwards and affect all bodies and particles around it. Because electric fields can easily be shielded and disrupted by various objects, the true measurement and morphology of the sun's electrical field will be tricky. The electric field of the sun may be very weak locally, but tremendously powerful across the large distances of the solar system. The mainstream assumes that the sun and its environment is electrically neutral. Yet, the presence of Birkeland currents connecting the Earth and the sun challenge this assumption. The periodic filamentary discharges from the sun's atmosphere are certainly not indicative of an electrically neutral sun. Our sun appears to be truly electrodynamic. According to many astronomers, the amount of visible and conventional mass in our galaxy, as well as others, is insufficient to account for its morphology and its velocity profile. In order for the observed anomalies to fit the gravity-centric theory, a new type of matter has been hypothesized. This has been labeled as dark matter, and while scientists state that it cannot be directly measured, it does have gravitational influence. Black holes, essentially an area of tremendous mass, have been hypothesized to exist at the center of galaxies. Presumably to explain why the observed mass and energy is greatest at the center. Yet, nobody has actually provided evidence of the existence of black holes. Their existence is merely hypothesized in order to describe the perceived masses and energies that are observed in particular locations. The existence of magnetic fields in galaxies has been known about for some time, albeit the process and origin of their formation has never really been claimed to be understood. The fact that magnetic fields run mostly parallel to the optical massive spiral arms in some galaxies is also poorly understood by the mainstream. Even in galaxies which lack any optical spiral structure, the magnetic field still forms the characteristic spiral structure. The mainstream scientists claim that the earliest galaxies probably obtained their magnetism from energetic jets produced by black holes or ejection of matter from the first stars that formed as a result of gravitational collapse. However, in order to sustain the fields in today's galaxies, some mechanism needs to be in place. They claim that in many galaxies, a dynamo process transfers mechanical energy into the magnetic energy that is observed. For this, they claim that the turbulent and fluid movement of gases in the galaxy can generate large-scale fields that are sustained. But does plasma really behave in such a way? Astronomers assume that gas turbulence from supernovas, star formation, and magnetic energy transference via differential galactic rotation play a role in determining the magnetic profile of galaxies. But still, these cannot account for all that is observed. In the early 1980s, Anthony Perrat, a plasma physicist at Los Alamos Laboratory, used supercomputers to simulate the interactions of plasma clouds that could lead to galaxy formation. He used the principles of interacting magnetic field-aligned electric currents, called Birkeland currents, after the scientist Christian Birkeland, to simulate the formation of galaxies without the need for dark matter or dark energy, or gravity as the only force. Here, two spherical clouds of plasma confined within magnetic filaments start to spin around each other until they form a spiral shape. Perrat observed that the rotation curves, radiation profiles, and velocity profiles of the simulated galaxy evolutions seem to match those observed in real galaxies. He also found that spiral galaxies were the final evolution in a series of changes that would happen to a galaxy upon its conception. By running his simulation further in conceptual light years in time, Perrat found that double radio galaxies transitioned to radio quasars, to radio quiet QSOs, and then onto peculiar or Seyfert galaxies, eventually ending up in the spiral form. Antony Peratt's simulation is quite similar to the work of Winston H. Bostick, a plasma physicist, whose laboratory experiments in the 1950s produced galactic formations in glass jars. Winston Bostick's experiment involved the creation of a plasma gun device, where a glass jar with a diameter of 4 inches was surrounded by wire carrying an electric current, which resulted in the generation of a small magnetic field. After removing the majority of the air from the jar, Bostick connected 2 high current and high voltage carrying titanium wires to the jar. When the electric current ran through the titanium wires, they vaporized and produced tiny particles of ionized material, traveling at hundreds of thousands of miles an hour. In carefully monitoring each of these experiments, Bostick observed that the cloud of gas often evolved into galactic-like shapes. The recent discovery of a huge bipolar bubble of radiation emanating from the center of our galaxy opens the door to a fundamental realization about galactic formation. The gamma ray bubbles have a north-south morphology and extend many thousands of light years outwards. The mainstream scientific community cannot profess to understand the origin, but their hypotheses usually resort to exotic phenomena such as the black hole and electron interactions with stellar winds. Instead, the bipolar morphology of these gamma ray structures resembles the same essential bipolar morphology that can be found when electric currents are compressed by powerful magnetic fields to form a high-energy plasmoid at the center. The overall phenomenon is known as the Bennett pinch. We see this in many bipolar nebulae. And we see it clearly in high-energy double radio galaxies. And in high-energy starburst galaxies. Soon we may come to the realization that all galaxies essentially possess a north-south energetic morphology. Hannes Alfvén didn't explicitly claim galaxies to be Bennett pinches. However, he did view them as part of an electrical circuit where 2 currents, one to the north and one to the south, are produced by the powerful magnetic field at the central region where the galaxy resides. The rotation of the magnetic field also creates electric currents with their own magnetic fields, and thus the galactic plane is similar to a Faraday motor. Perhaps the anomalous rotation, which mainstream scientists cannot attribute to the gravitational force from normal matter, may actually result from electric currents rather than dark matter. The cause of powerful plasma jets emanating from certain galaxies can thus be explained without resorting to phenomena such as black holes. The discharges result from the capacitive, resistive, and inductive features associated with the plasmoid. If our own Sun is essentially a plasmoid formed by the compression of dark mode Birkeland currents, then it presents itself as a not too dissimilar microcosmic example of a galactic center. The equator of the Sun possesses anomalous rotation, which has no satisfiable explanation if one considers gravity alone. And the Sun's magnetic field has the same essential spiral morphology that can be found in galaxies. Many bipolar nebulae in our skies may resemble the same process that occurs in a laboratory device known as the dense plasma focus. This device is composed of a series of cylindrical outer electrodes that surround one large hollow inner electrode. A low-pressure gas fills the chamber which contains the electrodes. An intense electric current is discharged from a capacitor bank for a very brief period, literally a few millionths of a second, and this current travels from the outer to the inner electrode. The electric current manifests itself in the form of small filaments of plasma constrained by magnetic fields as the energy travels through the gas from the outer electrodes to the inner. The small filaments of plasma travel to the end of the inner electrode and merge together, creating a powerful concentration of electromagnetic energy. The filaments produce strong local magnetic fields that pinch the filaments into a tiny ball of plasma known as a plasmoid. As the magnetic fields start to collapse, they create a powerful beam of electrons flowing in one direction and a beam of ionized atoms in the other. The plasmoid can reach very high temperatures as a result of this energetic release. Atoms in the low-pressure gas can rapidly collide with each other as a result of the energy generated, producing fusion reactions that generate more energy. The beam of ionized atoms can end up containing more energy than the actual electric current which produced the plasmoid in the first place. The morphology of the dense plasma focus can be seen here, with the filaments merging together to create a focus of energy. Many nebulae seem to show the cosmic equivalent of two plasma focus beams merging together. Since this is a dynamic process, the manifestations of a focused plasma current are going to vary out there in space. The symmetrical emissions of plasma, often in the form of apparent jets, also match the process in the plasma focus device with their ion and electron beams. The filaments that merge to create the central galactic focus of energy are actually invisible and non-thermal. This is because of the fact that although the electron current may be moving rapidly, the actual current density is not enough to cause enough collisions with local atoms and protons. A sufficient amount of flowing electron collisions with local atoms or protons in a space plasma results in energy release in the form of photons, that is, visible light. The space plasma starts to glow. The tremendous densities and masses at the center of galaxies can thus be explained as a highly dense focus of plasma producing an energetic plasmoid. The plasmoid produced in the dense plasma focus fusion device is very dense indeed, and energetic jets of electrons and ions are produced in bipolar jets. In our galaxy, matter that is trapped within the dense plasma focus can store tremendous amounts of electromagnetic energy that builds up over time. The dense plasmoid is thus the driver of galaxies, rather than any need for a black hole to be the driver. Any true cosmology needs to have a true interdisciplinary approach in explaining the world around us, the skies above, as well as the human condition itself. The electric and plasma cosmology approach can herald a potential revolution in scientific thought and impact all the major disciplines. A growing band of researchers, scholars, and passionate students are starting to gain ground in disseminating the electric paradigm to the next generation of keen minds. Maybe one day they will push this paradigm out of the niche realm in which it resides. Can we really come to know where we are going as a species? Can we foresee the future of our universe? Can we foresee whether there was ever a beginning to all things? Yet such questions cannot yet be resolved and may remain as impenetrable mysteries, at least for now. But for now, we can come to realize that we are not part of a disconnected and islandized universe. Our planet and sun are not isolated bodies in a cold vacuum. We are all interconnected in a complex circuit, an ebb and flow in the unified current of existence.